Welcome to part 2 of my tutorial series on MOT salvaging, where I show you how easy it is to turn a broken microwave into some cool projects. If you've just stumbled across this video, go watch part 1 first. It explains how to get a microwave oven transformer and tear it down the easy way. This video got a bit long, so I split it. In this video, we start with a transformer core and go through the general procedure for redesigning it into whatever new transformer your project requires. So that includes core selection, turns count, and wire size. Warning! Boring science content! You need some science. No one can give you fixed plans and measurements, or anticipate every question you might have for every project. So even though this tutorial isn't for a specific project, you have to learn to be your own engineer and know a little bit about electricity to solve your own problems. Don't worry, it's just basic arithmetic. If math and science scare you, just listen to the concepts, because if you understand those, it becomes common sense. In fact, if you know the concepts, you can usually skip the math, cut corners, or just guess. Regardless, I made a cheat sheet at the end with a procedure for you to follow, so that you just take any specs and your new measurements and drop them into place. Core selection. Transformers come in a huge range of sizes and configurations. The type that comes out of a microwave is just one of those types. But any of the projects I teach you to make with MOTs were selected to be suitable for that size and type. However, even among microwaves, the transformer sizes vary from about 500 to 1500 watts a unit, so the project you pick for each salvage transformer matters. Now, if you only ever want to build one project ever, and you already decided on what it is, and you'll only ever have one microwave to take apart, then you won't get to pick. You'll just have to use what you have and make it work. But for everyone else who's not settled and has lots of ideas, you should know how a transformer works so you can make smart choices and have accurate expectations. The main purpose of a transformer is to transform the voltage level and sometimes to raise the maximum amps available. Here's how it works. You have a voltage level that comes out of the socket in your home. For North America, it's 120 volts, and in Europe and other places, it's 240. The problem is that that's usually too high and sometimes too low of a voltage to be useful for many applications, so that's why we use transformers to step the voltage up or down. The parts of a transformer that work this magic you've already seen. You need two or more coils which create and absorb magnetic fields, and then you need a core that helps contain and direct the magnetic fields from one core to the other. And that's it, that's a transformer. When you input AC voltage to only one coil, called the primary coil, even though the other coil, called the secondary, isn't connected to the primary by any wires or other electrical means, you get an AC voltage out of it. The only connections between the coils are the invisible magnetic fields. So we have the wrong voltage from the socket, and we use a transformer to get us the right voltage to power a project. Then it's just a matter of scale. Should you use a big core to make a big transformer, or a little core to make a little one? Power, measured in watts, is the product of the voltage level and the amount of amps that are flowing. A transformer can provide the same amount of wattage to the secondary as it can consume from the primary, even though the mixture of volts and amps is different on each coil. This means if you want a higher voltage, you won't be able to draw as many amps from it, or if you only need a lower voltage, your maximum amps will increase. A transformer is limited by its size in the amount of power it can handle. That's how you know how big a transformer core should be. The more wattage you need to transform, the bigger the transformer has to be. To estimate the short-term power handling ability of an MOT, just weigh it. It's about 100 watts per pound. Your project plans will tell you what voltage and amps it needs, and those will be different for every project. In many cases, you'll want to match the voltage in the plans, but then just have as many amps available as possible. The more amps available, the more powerful the device can be. If you have a selection of cores, use the smallest MOT that works for your application so you can save the bigger ones for bigger projects that need more power. All of this will make more sense when you start looking into specific projects where these details are given. That's all you really need to know about what core to use. Turns count. Our goal in redesigning the transformer is to set the voltage level on the secondary, which is our output, so that it's useful for whatever device it's powering. Now with transformers, we can't set the absolute voltage, we can only set the voltage proportions between the coils. But the method is very simple. The voltage ratio between the two coils will be the same as the turns ratio between the two coils. So if you wrap twice as many turns on the secondary, it will have double the voltage of the primary. If you wrap half as many, it'll have half the voltage, and so on. To select the voltage we want, we need to wrap the correct number of turns on the new secondary. To calculate how much that should be, we need the other three pieces of info, but we already know them. The input voltage, always 120, the output voltage, given by the project specs, and the number of turns in the primary, which we're usually reusing. Then we'll know how many loops the secondary needs. So how many turns did that primary have? Well, there's three ways to figure it out. One way is to unwind the primary and count the number of turns, or figure it out by counting rows and columns, but that might be tricky. That's the stupid way. Don't do that. The second way is to not figure it out and not even do any math. Here's a shortcut. Most MOT primaries have close to 120 turns, which, since there's 120 volts coming out of your wall, is, by coincidence, one turn per volt. Now, that doesn't hold true for many other types of transformers or other sizes, but it just so happens to be generally true for MOTs. So if accuracy isn't too important for your project, or you hate math, you could simply wrap as many turns as the voltage number you want. If you want 12 volts, put 12 turns. If you want 24, then 24. If you want 2,000 volts, then wrap 2,000 turns. That's the lazy way. You can't always be lazy, so the third way requires some scrap insulated wire and a cheap multimeter. They are 10 or 15 bucks at any hardware or electronics store. Take the wire and wrap a quick 10-turn test coil. Power up the primary and actually measure the AC voltage. Since you know the secondary turns in voltage and the primary voltage, you can calculate the number of turns on the primary rather than guessing. Then you can insert that missing piece to figure out how many turns to get your desired voltage. That's the precise way. If you don't have a multimeter, don't worry. You'll probably end up calculating that you were accurate enough being lazy. As a quick note, don't think that you're better off to just trim turns from the primary so that you won't need as many turns on the secondary. For reasons we won't get into, that would have disastrous consequences. In brief, for transformers to work without melting down, there is a bottom limit on turns per volt. MOTs are cheap and poorly made and already skirting that bottom limit. In fact, as we'll cover later, they're often improved by adding extra turns to the primary. For our purposes, never have less than one turn per volt on the primary, which means just leave them alone or add more. Now that you know how many turns to wrap, the second thing you have to do is select the right wire size. Generally, for high power projects, you're trying to get as much wire as you can into the empty space in the core. Otherwise, you might as well have used a smaller transformer core. But you have two constraints. One is that you get the correct number of turns, no more and no less, or you'll get the wrong voltage. The other constraint is that the core only has so much space. You'll want to use heavy enough wire that when you wrap the correct number of turns, it all fits, but with little room to spare so you get the most out of your transformer. That makes it a simple 2D geometry problem. Looking through the cross section, some of the core space is taken up by the primary and the rest is available. Measure the length and the width of the available space. That's a rectangle, so length times width equals area. Write that down. Now, when you're wrapping wire, you won't be perfect. There is going to be some air, and the wire won't fit perfectly into the available space, so aim low. If you were a machine in a factory, you might get as good as about 80%, but since you're human and you're watching a tutorial, 50 to 60% would be a good target. And I'm not dumbing you down, that's about the best I can do too. Better to have extra space, which will also help with cooling, than not enough space and having to start over with thinner wire. So take your rectangle area and get rid of 40 to 50% of it that you won't be able to fill, and write down the new area estimate. Then divide that number by the number of turns we figured out that your secondary should have inside that area, and then write that result down. That number is the max cross-sectional area of the wire, including its insulation, that you have room for. But that's not too useful yet. What's useful is simply knowing how thick the wire should be. So here comes the math. Divide the per wire area by 3.14, take the square root of it, then double the result. Done. Don't be scared, it's just math, your calculator does it all for you. Let's move on to the common sense. By now you might have noticed something obvious. The more turns you need to fit into an area, the thinner the wire has to be to have room for them all. This is relevant because, if you remember from earlier, the more turns you have, the more volts you'll get. And since you know the transformer has power limitations, the more volts you'll get, the fewer amps you can draw. The purpose of wire is to carry the amps, and the thicker the wire, the more amps it can carry. So everything works out perfectly. When you need a high voltage, you'll need a large amount of turns, which means you'll need thin wire to fit all the turns in. But that's okay, because with a high voltage, you'll only be able to draw a low amount of amps, which is all the thin wire could carry anyway without overheating. And the reverse is true on the other end. Lower voltage, fewer turns, thicker wire, more amps available, and thick enough wire to carry all those amps. It's always self-scaling. Brain full yet? Remember that cheat sheet I promised? Pause the video, copy this down, I'll explain the rest later. Your transformer design is now done, and you should have three things. 1. The size of the core that fits your project. 2. The number of turns on your secondary. And 3. The overall wire size, including insulation. If you have those, great. Except that I lied to you. The numbers you have are probably wrong and will need adjusting later. Good practice, though. Moving on. Now go watch part 3, the exciting conclusion, where I teach you how to build the coils and mount everything back together, hopefully without burning your house down. If one MOT isn't big enough for you, why not more? I've seen projects with as many as 16. You can only get 1800 watts out of a normal household circuit, which means about 2 MOTs are the most you can hook up without a special setup. If you hook them up with all the secondaries in series or parallel, just note that now the polarity and phase will matter. So if you end up getting nearly 0 volts, it means the transformers have opposite phases. It sounds complicated, but to fix it, just swap the output terminals on one of the transformers. Even more efficient than using two separate transformers is if you can get a pair of identical cores. They only have to be identical when looking at the E. The depth or core stack direction isn't as critical. Then you can throw away the eyes and stack them together E to E and end up with a supersized transformer. You'll want to wire the two primaries in parallel and wrap a single big secondary. Or if you wanted to run your transformer from a 240 volt socket like an oven or clothes dryer uses, wire your primary's head to tail in series so the new primary has 240 turns.